God is calling us to worship. God sees with holy eyes. God sees with holy eyes. God sees with holy eyes. Some boast of chariots and horses, says the psalm, but we boast of the Lord our God. Trusting in the Lord, let us pray, the responsive prayer printed in the bulletin. God of wisdom, we do not see as you see. We look at others and make snap judgments. We look at appearances, but you look into the heart. We look down on small things, but you see how it's small. Forgive us. Open our hearts to love as you love. In your mercy, reconcile us to truth and goodness, and to faith beyond that which is merely seen. Through Jesus Christ, Redeemer. Amen. Confess our sins, God forgives us of our sins and cleanses us from all unrighteousness.
in Christ Jesus, you are forgiven. And since you have been forgiven, let us forgive one another. And the peace of Christ be with you. And let us share that peace.
Peace to you.
And also with you. Good to see you.
Let us pray. Lord, your Spirit is poured out, and all things grow and benefit. Pour out your Spirit now upon us, that we may read and hear your word and be blessed by it. Amen. The reading today is from 1 Samuel. Then Samuel went to Ramah, and Saul went up to his house. Samuel did not see Saul again until the day of his death, but Samuel grieved over Saul, and the Lord was sorry that he had made Saul king over Israel. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse, the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." The Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his son's appearance or on the height of their stature, because I have rejected them. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward.
turn also to our gospel reading this day from Mark, the 4th chapter. Kind of a familiar parable. It seems that Jesus was always talking about the kingdom of God being somehow like a seed or like a field or like some other agricultural image. And so Jesus is at it again today. Let us stand together for the reading of the gospel. And Jesus said, God's kingdom is like what happens when a farmer scatters seed in a field. The farmer sleeps at night and is up and around during the day. Yet the seeds keep sprouting and growing, and he doesn't understand how. It is the ground that makes the seeds sprout and grow into plants that produce grain. Then when harvest season comes and the grain is ripe, the farmer cuts it with a sickle. Finally, Jesus said, what is God's kingdom like? What story can I use to explain it? It's like what happens when a mustard seed is planted in the ground. It is the smallest seed in all the world, but once it's planted, it grows larger than any garden plant. It even puts out branches that are big enough for birds to nest in its shade. And this is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. The Gospels tell us clearly that Jesus spoke with authority, and I'm sure that's true, but it does seem occasionally, just occasionally, that Jesus might have benefited from the services of a fact checker. The parable of the mustard seed is a case in point. The mustard seed is very, very small, that much is true. But a mustard seed would never grow into a plant the size of a bush, big enough for birds to roost in its branches. Telling the parable this way, Jesus seems to be exaggerating. And Jesus is up to something. Odd stories, circulate on the internet. This week I saw a picture of an 11-pound bullfrog that somebody had gigged out of a ditch in Sulphur, Louisiana. Now, I've been to Sulphur, Louisiana, with the spring heat down there and the insects and the water from Lake Charles. An 11-pound bullfrog sounds almost reasonable. But, of course, a frog that big isn't possible. Even in South Louisiana, bullfrogs top out at about a pound and a half. Still, a thing like that, it gets your attention. On the internet, the picture was kind of one of these tricks of perspective, but it was a good trick. It does catch your interest. Your imagination needs to be exercised. And so maybe, just maybe, you're willing to entertain the impossibility that, hey, there might be an 11-pound bullfrog out there somewhere. Well, this is likely the kind of thing that Jesus was up to also when he told the one about the mustard seed that grows as big as a magnolia tree. He wanted us to be intrigued about what he was saying so that we would pay attention and so that we would stretch our thinking and even our theological imagination. On Pentecost, which was just 3 weeks ago, that great day for people with theological imaginations, that day when the Spirit came down like a rushing wind and thrilled the disciples and made them able to speak clearly, for the first time clearly, about the Lord. On that day, I quoted the novelist John Updike, who wrote, "The world is more than iron and stone and effort and fear." Let us pray for that. We do want to believe in possibilities, that the world is not just ordinary things, iron and stone and effort and fear. We want to believe in possibilities. We want there to be miracles that are happening around us that we can experience. We hope to break out of whatever rut we might be in so that we can see a new horizon. We want so badly to believe that life is more than what meets the eye. Well, does imagining a mustard plant 10 feet tall and grown that large by spring so that birds can make their nests in it, does such a thing help us believe in the theological possibility of the coming kingdom of God? It's a start. Jesus does want us to have an open mind about this concept of God's rule coming onto the earth. Don't give up on what God is doing, Jesus seems to say. God may even yet do something that will surprise and delight you. God may call on you to take part in the fulfillment of God's purposes. Over the years, I've kind of nourished an odd interest in world record-sized pumpkins. People do grow these things for county fairs and such, and I'll report that the current champ is a 2,323.7-pound pumpkin that was grown in Switzerland. These pumpkins are so big that while they're still growing, while the grower can still lift them, they have to be lifted up onto a reinforced pallet so that a forklift can pick them up at the time of the weigh-in. And it all starts with seeds, of course. There is one instance of a single seed from a record pumpkin being sold, actually was auctioned, for $1,600. Imagine that for a pumpkin seed. Well, people do want stuff like this to be possible. People do want their lives to contain miracles, and we want that so badly that maybe we'd shell out $1,600 for a single hopeful seed, and then we'd plant it, and then we'd water the heck out of it just to see what comes up. It's in that spirit that Jesus tells us about a mustard bush that grows so wonderfully big that the birds can make their nests in it. Alert hearers will note that Jesus is saying something about the mustard bush that is exactly what the prophet Ezekiel once said about a sprig of cedar. When Ezekiel talks about that cedar, he's imagining the long-awaited Savior. He imagines that little sprig growing to a tree, a cedar of enormous height, and that spreading tree, that magnificent plant, was for Ezekiel a sign that the Savior was coming. It says, "And I will plant it that it may become a noble cedar," says Ezekiel, "and under it will dwell all kinds of beasts. In the shade of its branches, birds of every sort will nest." Well, that great cedar was a sign to the people of what God was doing, of an age yet to come, and the cooperation of the birds and the beasts in the shade of the tree is kind of suggestive of what the prophet Elijah said about the peaceable kingdom of God, which was, of course, another fulfillment of God's purposes. The scholars tell us that these kinds of visions, they call them eschatological visions. Eschatological because they tell us about final things. They tell us especially about the grand and final fulfillment of all the glorifying purposes of the Lord Almighty. What we know about how things will turn out, how this world will end, what we know about those things is limited. But we do know that whatever happens will be in God's hands. We get our ideas from the Old Testament prophets and also, of course, from Jesus. The eschaton, that end of time, will be characterized by profound peace. The lamb will be safe, says Isaiah, lying down with the wolf. There will be justice. The people will hear the kind of good news that they've never heard before. Now, that's not the world we're living in right now, but it is the way of God. It is the purpose and will of God. And so it is the world that will one day surely turn out to be God's kingdom. We really don't see the way from here to there very easily. We don't see how that kingdom might come to grow among us. But neither do we really see how a tiny seed can become a great plant, or how faith can move mountains, or how faith can bring us into the massive work that God wants us to do in this world. I had a barber one time who showed me a picture of a 4-pound tomato he had grown. That's a really big tomato. A thing like that fires the jets of your imagination. And you'd better believe that my barber saved some of the seeds from that giant tomato so he could try again for an even bigger one the next year. What are you saving? What do you harbor in your heart with the intention of going to work for God? The man scattering the seed in the gospel knows nothing really about how a seed sprouts and grows. The earth produces of itself, the text says. In fact, the farmer, it seems, sort of goes about his ordinary daily routine. The Bible tells us he sleeps and rises night and day. And the mystery of what might happen is not lost on him. After all, he is the one who scattered the seed. But he doesn't make the miracle happen. That's the same way as it is with the kingdom of God. We wait for it. We prepare for it, we imagine it, but we do not make it happen. The final fulfillment of all things, in the end, is God's work. So, with all of that in mind, what's the most hopeful thing you've ever done? Some people say having a child is the most hopeful thing. You work hard, you endure a lot, you pray a lot when you're a parent. Isn't that the way we're supposed to live into God's kingdom too? Working, praying, hoping. Hard work, but work that's sustained every step of the way. Or applying for a job, that's a hopeful thing. Or training for a new job. Or deciding to marry. All of those things, I maintain, we do without really knowing what we're getting into. There is a mystery in these turns and changes that our lives take. But along with the uncertainty, there is some confidence too. We do believe that something good will happen. You know that when you marry, when you take a new job, when you have a child, that it'll be something good and renewing and powerful. The future that God is making is so full of possibility and always has been. That's how faith lives into the kingdom of God, knowing that it'll be good. Working for it, but knowing that our work and everything is still somehow in God's hands. Jesus, of course, believes that this world is a place where astonishing things can happen. The resurrection was an astonishing thing. The love of God, so amazing, so divine. Resistance to evil. The pursuit of peace. Looking out for the kingdom of God will always turn church people back toward the church. That's what we try to do together here. Hope of a certain kind is nurtured when we gather as a church. Our work seems to be kingdom work, and we're doing it together. We are blessed here. We are engaged by God's Holy Spirit. God is here. Believing in possibilities, seeking God's way, and don't discount what might happen. Well, you can even begin to experience some of that right now in this sanctuary, this beautiful place, this transcendent, quiet sanctuary, so full as it is of God's presence, so full as it is of all of you, the sweetest people I can think of, the best people I know. Here we are in this quiet sanctuary, and each of us feels the presence of God. The smallest seed, when it is sown today, brings us the amazement and the fulfillment of tomorrow and the fulfillment of hope. Let us live like that. And thanks be to God. Amen. I do want to say a word of special welcome to visitors who are with us this day. I see some of your faces out there, and I hope on the way out the door perhaps you'll introduce yourself to me. Especially, we're grateful to have some Vampy students with us. It always makes us feel smarter to have those special students, and so thank you all for being here. Also, if anyone is visiting and would like to have more of a part in the ministry that we share together, I encourage you to speak to me about that following the service. We can put the handles in your hands so that you can be part of what God is doing through this church. And now let us all pray. Lord, we thank you for the magic and the mystery and the miracle of your kingdom coming among us. We wait for it, but we pray, help us to live as citizens of that kingdom even now. Bless us in our fellowship. Bless us as we seek to spread your love and peace and your hope in the world. And these things we pray in Christ our Lord. Amen. Our affirmation of faith this week comes to us from the brief statement of faith, and it's printed in our order of service. Together, let us say what we believe. In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. And please be seated.
Let us pray. O God of grace and mystery, you are always with us and yet in faraway places. Speak to us again this morning. We are constantly trying to figure you out in reflection, debate, in reading and philosophy. We try to figure you out. We want to square the circle, get a handle on you that fits the rational and comprehensible. But you escape our narrowness and our attempts to box you in. Why did you not come from Alberton or attend Western or just say out loud that you are a Presbyterian? For you do not belong to us, God. You do not belong to human systems, to philosophical concepts, or scientific laws. You do not belong to us, but we belong to you. And in life and in death, we belong to you, our God. And in this is our hope and our salvation. We keep trying to figure you out, but you have figured us out. You know our wants and needs. You have figured out our hurt and brokenness. You have figured out our potential for wholeness and healing and love. And in Jesus Christ, you come to us with a yoke that is light, with a word of friendship, and with a call to discipleship. So now that you have us, we pray that you would transform us and our community and our land. And this day we pray for all who struggle with illness, who are recovering from surgery. Especially do we pray for Hank Hansen. And we will miss Lou Mary Carwell, who died yesterday, and ask that you be with her family in the coming days. And we also ask for the family of Andy McLaren. Be with them as they grieve Andy's death this week. And be with our children this summer. And we want no one in our city or land to die of gun violence when there are plenty of double plays to be turned in this summer. And be with our children. And thanks for the wonderful music of the Fort Hood Boys Choir that we heard on Wednesday evening. And we pray for all of those who are sitting close to us this morning. And we want no one to leave here today who's not been prayed for. So let us pray for those close by now. Let us pray as we were taught to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We learn by experience that it feels good to give. It is a blessing to be able to meet the needs of others. It is a blessing to see the church thrive. It is a blessing to support the work in which we are all involved. Blessings are for sharing. Let us come before God with our tithes and our offerings.
Every evening sky, an invitation to trace the pattern stars. And early in July, a celebration for freedom that is ours. And I notice you in children's games, in those who watch them from the shade. Every drop of sun is full of fun and wonder. You are summer. And even when the trees have just surrendered to the harvest time, forfeiting their leaves in late September and sending us inside, still I notice you when change begins and I am braced for colder winds. I will offer thanks for what has been and what's to come. You are everything in time and under heaven finally falls asleep, wrapped in blankets white. All creation shivers underneath. Still I notice you when branches crack and in my breath on frosted glass. Even now in death, you open doors for life to enter. You are winter, and everything that's new has bravely surfaced, teaching us to breathe. And what was frozen through is newly purposed.